Hello, this is Barbara Fix and Rabbi Amiel Wall. Our Rabbi Wall show is about the Middle East and about Israel. And we're very happy to have Rabbi Wall on the show today because we missed him last week. Rabbi Wall, hello.
Yes,
are you with us?
Hello, Barbara. I'm down here in southwest Florida in the beautiful area called Naples, Florida. It really is all that they say it is and lots more. But we are undiminished in our desire to bring you the latest news and information on the Middle East world and other ideas that come out at this moment, too. And we're glad that you're able to assume some direction for the show. And we all wish Judge Fredman the best as he recovers. And we're grateful to all the people who support us and who listen regularly, call in, and write in to tell us. So, Barbara, you go ahead now, and let's hear what you're bringing today for the rabbi and the Middle East era.
Well, it's going to be a very interesting program, Rabbi Wall, for two reasons. One is we want to hear from you about the two holidays of today and tomorrow. We have Simchas Torah and Shemini Atzeret. And also another reason, because I have in the studio with me a fascinating gentleman by the name of Lou Kerner. Lou is the epitome of a combination of a love of Israel and a phenomenally in-depth knowledge of the business world, on the technology side. Right. So we will first let's hear about the holidays, Rabbi Wall, seeing it Shemini Atzeret and Simchas Torah, and our listeners sure want to hear about that.
Well, people who are observant of biblical truths and forces can understand that the season that followed the high holy days and went into agricultural remembrance and the building of the sukkah and all the outstanding and happy holidays that the Jewish people created in the 2,000 years of diaspora living. Among them was Shemini Atzeret, to lengthen the days, one more festival day celebrating the land of Israel and all of that means and implies, and the consecration of little children and the hakafos, that is, marching with the Torah in circles to proclaim its truth, the truth of the first five books of the Bible, and little children just beginning their religious training, five-year-olds, six-year-olds, seven-year-olds, and even 10-year-olds are brought forward to the front of the sanctuary, given miniature Torahs, the scroll of the law, and they begin their important job of learning and expressing their Jewish heritage and faith. But now, so with that in mind, that we're in a festive season one more day, we're glad that people are listening and getting an authentic voice to relay the truths that we have. Go ahead now, please, and let's hear the special guest.
Yes. Lou, you're very interesting, but I'd like you to tell us a little bit about how you became, your background, and how you became connected to Israel.
Sure. Well, Barbara, thank you very much for that kind introduction. I actually, this is a career three for me. I started as an equity analyst on Wall Street following media and tech companies, and then I actually ran some tech companies, the most successful of which was Every Country Has Their Own Top Level Domain. Israel is .il. Most of us use .com. There's a little island nation in the South Pacific called Tuvalu that was blessed with the top-level domain .tv, and we licensed it from them and commercialized it. And then I angel invested for a number of years and started a VC fund in July of 2012. And while I was investing that fund, VC, you know, it's a venture capital fund investing in private companies, I read a book by Yehuda Avner called The Prime Ministers. And it's an amazing book about a 20-year-old kid from the UK who comes to Palestine in 46, gets a low-level job in government, and by the early 60s, he's the right-hand guy to five prime ministers, and it's an amazing history of Israel. And when I finished the book, I was shocked at how alone Israel was, that the United States really wasn't the friend that I thought it was. Not that I was upset at the United States, it just turns out the agendas are often quite different. And so when I finished that, I decided I wanted to help Israel. That led me to AIPAC, and as a VC, that led me also to being open to investing in Israeli companies. And that's really how I started investing in Israel.
You're very modest, because I know that you are a very senior equity analyst. You were at Goldman Sachs, is that correct?
That's right.
And then you retired very young from that particular position, not thinking that you'd go back into being an analyst again, and you kind of got co-opted into, was that a second career, a third career?
Well, I left Goldman, much to the chagrin of my wife, in January of 2000, when the internet was going crazy, and I actually followed cable companies, and everybody I met who was a cable operator was a billionaire, and I realized it was because they owned monopolies. And so while I actually really liked being an equity analyst, I thought if I can think of an idea for an internet monopoly, I would leave Wall Street and do that. And as I mentioned, the top-level domain .tv, that's a monopoly. Nobody could build a bigger, better, faster .tv web address than us. If you wanted a domain name ending in .tv, you had to buy it from us. So that's when I left Wall Street.
Well, listen, right. We have calls.
Rabbi Wall, do you have a question?
Yes, we do want to invite people to call in 914-0110 to ask a comment or make a question.
Yeah, please call in 914-636-0110 if you have a question for the rabbi, certainly about these complex holidays, as we know we've just finished Sukkot and now Simchas Torah and Shmini Atzeret. And also we're talking about Israel as a startup nation. And we're talking with Lou Kerner, who's a partner at Flight VC, where he manages the Israel Founders Syndicate, an angels list. And he's going to tell us, because of the success of Israel, how we, the man in the street, would be able to even invest in some of these amazing startup companies, because Israel has been at the forefront of changing technology. And I mentioned that Israel is a startup nation. There was a book by that name too, Lou. Is that correct? The Startup Nation. I trust that you read that book about it.
Yes, most definitely. You know, if you look at Israel statistically, they start more companies per capita than any other country in the world. They have more exits. In other words, more of them get acquired than any other company. More IPOs, and it's not just by a little bit, but it's by more than a factor of two than any other country in the world. And so a professor from Harvard wrote a book in 2010 titled Startup Nation, trying to understand why it was that Israel was so successful at starting companies, but also starting successful companies.
And the reason for that, there was some people were asking as to why is it that Israel is able to be at the forefront of such radical inventions. I mean, do you have explanations?
Well, sure. I have my own experience. I can tell you from the book what I learned, and which I really found to be true, was it really all starts from the military. As I'm sure you know, almost every Israeli, when they're 18, goes into the army. And if they're really talented, by the time they're 20 years old, they're often in charge of 100 or 200, other junior soldiers. And so they're getting world-class training in leadership that no other 20-year-old in the world is getting. And you couple that leadership training with getting world-class technology training. So many of the jobs in the Army are they're learning technical skills, they're learning cybersecurity skills, they're learning satellite imaging skills, and they then take those skills when they leave the Army. And while the minimum they have to serve is 2 years, almost everybody I meet serves at least 5 or 6 years. And then when they leave the Army, they take these amazing leadership skills that they have and the amazing technical skills they have, and they start companies.
Right. And many of them go to one of the fine universities. One particular one is called the Technion, and you, in fact, working with people at the Technion. What is your connection?
Sure. Well, the Technion is an amazing academic institution. I was shocked when I first started getting involved that it was actually started in 1917, because the forefathers of Israel recognized that when Israel became a country, they were going to need engineers because they were going to need to build dams and they were going to need to have all kinds of other infrastructure.
Oh, so getting into wonderful topics, but we're going to have to take a break, and then we'll be back after the break with Lou Kerner and Rabbi Wall talking about Israel in the Middle East.
News at 20 past the hour. Here's the latest update from the Fox Business Network on 1460 WVOX.
From the Fox Business Network, shares of both AT&T and Time Warner are lower following the announcement that AT&T has agreed to buy Time Warner for $85.4 billion. The deal is expected to get a close look from regulators at a time when lawmakers have become skeptical of consolidation in the media industry. When it comes to buying up companies around the globe, China has moved past the U.S. with a record $207 billion overseas buying spree. And the focus has shifted when it comes to the kind of companies China is now buying. Private entrepreneurs are snapping up Italian football teams, American film studios, and French fashion houses. Not everyone needs a smartwatch. In fact, the market for smartwatches has tumbled more than 50%. With the Fox Business Report, I'm Carol Zimmer.
If you are behind on your bills, then this message is for you. How would you like to have a large portion of your credit card debt or medical bills forgiven? National Credit Card Relief would like to give you free information on a proven debt forgiveness program. It's not bankruptcy. It's not consolidation. This special program actually wipes clean the portion of your debt that is forgiven. Call for your free forgiveness information now. 800-719-2090. That's 800-719-2090. Don't wait. Call 800-719-2090.
At least Donald and Hillary can agree on one thing. This is the best station in the nation.
It's just a fact.
And daily listening is mandatory.
The laws are very explicit.
1460 WVOX.
WVOX.
We're back on the radio after taking a break with Rabbi Wall, who's actually broadcasting from Florida. Rabbi Wall, you enjoying wonderful weather? Not that we have bad weather in New York. I have to say we had a couple of tough days, rain and a bit of wind, but it's nice to know that you and the enjoying the warmth of Naples.
It makes you just feel happy that you're in the blanket of love and good weather and all the blessings that are ours as Americans. And it brings to mind the fact that the United Nations is celebrating its anniversary since it was called into being and developed to be a peacemaker for the world and bring equity and justice to many more places. But somehow things have gone awry with the United Nations. They haven't fulfilled their mission, and instead they've become a place where people who are malignant are raising their issues, and the United States, as usual, is paying far more than its share to keep the UN in business. But it's something like the UN is needed, but this UN at this rate, at this time, it's worth considering, worth talking about.
Thank you for bringing that up, because we have a major problem with UNESCO that's voted, that's put to the vote whether the Jews have a connection to the Holy Land of Israel, and there is a denial of the connection of the Jews to the Temple Mount, to the First and Second Temple. It makes the UNESCO lose its credibility. It's very unfortunate. In fact, in a way, Rabbi Wall, I think Abba Eban, I'm going to quote, he was one of the most eloquent of Israeli diplomats, once noted when he was ambassador to the United Nations in the 60s, that if Algeria, this is just kind of a joke, but a quote, if Algeria introduced a resolution declaring the earth was flat and that Israel had flattened it, it would have passed by a vote of 164-13 with 26 abstentions. Well, that kind of has happened at UNESCO, where UNESCO has voted incorrectly, and but I believe that as of yesterday or today, the Italian Prime Minister Matteo Renzi called the resolution shocking and inconceivable, and he was summoning his foreign minister to find out why the Italy had abstained instead of voting against that resolution. His quote was to say that Jews have no link to Jerusalem is like saying the sun creates darkness. Well, I believe that the Mexican Foreign Ministry has also launched an investigation into this UNESCO vote, as has Brazil. So, and I think the Czech Parliament is also condemning it. So let's look around, and hopefully this UNESCO vote severing the connection of the Jews to the Holy Land is going to be overturned at some point. But thank you, Rabbi, for talking about the United Nations. And with your permission, Rabbi, I'm going to go back to Lou, because Lou was talking about wonderful things about Israel. He was talking about what it is, the secrets to Israel's success. And then he was also talking about, interestingly enough, about the one of the top institutions, the Technion, which was formed in, was it 1917, Lou, that you said?
Yeah, I believe that's correct. Mm-hmm. You know, many years, obviously, before Israel became a state. And now it's really the kind of Harvard and MIT of Israel, where a lot of the amazing technology coming out of Israel starts. For example, Iron Dome came out of technology developed at the Technion.
Interesting. The Technion, I think you were talking about actually getting to tour a facility where the Technion's going to have some roots in our own New York. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's really an amazing project. You know, Mayor Bloomberg, in his brilliance, decided that in order for New York to become a tech hub, it needed a great tech university. And so he asked all tech universities from around the world to put in a proposal. And the winning proposal was a partnership between Cornell and the Technion. And it's going up on Roosevelt Island. It opens up in fall of 2017. So in just 1 year, it will be open. In the interim, it's already operating at Google headquarters down in the Meatpacking District in New York. It's got actually a large facility there. Google's been incredibly kind. And there are a lot of graduate programs. And I'm actually involved in something called Runway, which is an accelerator. An accelerator is an ecosystem where companies can be started and the CEOs and starting team can get a lot of support. And it's an accelerator for postdocs. In other words, in order to be accepted into the accelerator, you actually have to have a PhD degree. And it is the most brilliant set of kids I've seen at any accelerator in the world. And it's really an amazing program. I'm really proud to be associated with it.
So this is the Technion involved in the Meatpacking District on a Google facility. And are most of these it's not exclusively for Jewish people, no, even though it's part of the Technion. They welcome everybody who has PhDs. Is that correct?
Yes. Anybody can apply to the Runway program. Anybody can apply to the Cornell Tech. It's actually only offering technical graduate degrees to start. That's the plan. And the Runway program in particular are for PhDs, and they don't have to be associated with either Cornell Technion or be Jewish.
Now, you mentioned a word called tech ecosystem. What is a tech ecosystem?
If you think about, an ecosystem where there are all kinds of different parts that come into play, in Israel, or in every city really has a technology ecosystem. And when the ecosystem is working well, it's a virtuous circle. In other words, in tech ecosystems in particular, you have people who will start companies and they'll have success, and they'll exit and generally make a lot of money from that exits, and then they'll take that capital and that knowledge and they'll start a new company, or they'll mentor and finance and new companies. And that's a big part of the reason why the Israel tech ecosystem is doing so well, is because it's a virtuous circle. One of the other reasons that I was really shocked by when I went to Israel and particularly Tel Aviv for the first time a couple years ago was, I always believed that Silicon Valley was Silicon Valley in large part because of how supportive the ecosystem was of each other. In other words, a significant...
Just as we get into something so fascinating, we have to take a break. Well, we'll keep the suspense. We'll take a break, and listeners, then call us in if you have questions for Lou Kerner or Rabbi Wall, 914-636-0110. We'll take a break now.
National news. Here is the latest update from Fox News Radio on 1460 WVOX.
Fox News Radio, I'm Paul Stevens. 15 days until Election Day, Donald Trump downplaying numerous polls showing him trailing Hillary Clinton. This as early voting gets underway in Florida.
Early voting so far today seems to be a real hit, and reports from balloting officials in many Florida counties are that lines are long, and that usually means parking problems, but many are just leaving cars on the grass or wherever they can find some room.
Fox's Evan Brown in Miramar, Florida. WikiLeaks releasing a new batch of emails from the account of Hillary Clinton's campaign chair, John Podesta.
In one email exchange between a number of staffers, there are several quotes from Clinton's Goldman Sachs speeches. Longtime advisor to Hillary Clinton, Mandy Grunwald, writes, "It's pretty bad. She is critical to some extent of what led to the crash, but the more memorable stuff is totally accommodationist."
Fox's Rachel Sutherland in Washington. Fox News, we report, you decide.
You make sure his toys don't have any sharp edges. You taught her what to do when the smoke alarm goes off and to wear a helmet when she rides her bicycle. You do so much to keep your child safe. But are you using the right car seat for your child? Car crashes are a leading killer of children ages 1 to 13. Protect your child's future at every stage of life. For information on the right seat for your child, visit safercar.gov/the right seat.
Sponsored by the New York State Governor's Traffic Safety Committee.
Let Metro North take you to all the fun in the city this fall. With late night service and our deals and getaway packages, a trip on Metro North can fit your schedule and your budget. Plus, save even more when you buy tickets before boarding with our eTix app. Visit mta.info to learn more.
Hi, this is Dr. Michael Finkelstein, and I'm excited to introduce you to my new show, Slow Medicine Radio. And we're going to talk about things that you might not have really heard before in such a way. I'm going to challenge the conventional wisdom of medical practice and get you to think beyond your body. Why? because you're struggling with the fast world and it is affecting you, and conventional medicine has no antidote for that. Indeed, you're exhausted by the rush of modern life. And that's why you need to listen to Slow Medicine Radio. On the show, I'll be speaking to some interesting people who will broaden our perspective on what health is and how to achieve a state of well-being we seek. And I'll be speaking to you as well. Slow Medicine Radio does not prescribe take this or do that. Instead, it offers an open-minded, intelligent, and practical approach to living, resulting in greater health individually and collectively.
Tune in Mondays at 5 p.m. Steve Pelletieri's Eye on Weather is brought to you on WVOX by Energy and the Indian Point Energy Center, right for New York.
Hi, this is meteorologist Steve Pelletieri for Westchester this afternoon. Mostly sunny, upper 50s, right around 60, and gusty northwest winds. Clear skies tonight in the lower 40s. Tuesday, mostly sunny. Highs of about 50 to 55. Clear weather at night, middle 30s. Wednesday, sunshine in the upper 40s. I'm meteorologist Steve Pelletieri for 1460 WVOX.
Teresa Motko is a senior systems engineer at Indian Point Energy Center.
I live with my husband Rich and our two kids, less than 4 miles from Indian Point. So when people talk about safety, it really is a personal issue to me. I think it's important to understand how rigorous the safety culture is at Indian Point. My engineering team trains constantly, and inspectors from the Nuclear Regulatory Commission are on site at all times, overseeing our operations. Indian Point has also invested over $1 billion in upgrades and strengthened safety equipment and backup systems. And every day, my team and I make sure that these layers upon layers of safety and security at Indian Point are as strong as they can be.
Nearly 1,000 people like Teresa work at Indian Point, and safety is their single most important mission. Learn more about the plant that generates about 25% of the power used in the city and Westchester each year at rightfornewyork.com.
Bob Marone in the morning, Fred Dicker in the afternoon, and so much more in between. We're the station where so many different voices are heard every day. 1460 WVOX.
Barbara Fix and Rabbi Amiel Wall, this time speaking from Florida. Rabbi Wall, welcome, and it's always lovely to be on the show. We missed you last week.
Hope you're settling in and doing well in Florida.
Do you have any comments or questions you'd like to make?
Well, I'd like to know if there's really any move going on with the United Nations to cut her back or to have her be more truthful, or some reforms. Are they in the works anywhere, or is it just a blind alley?
You know, it's very hard to know. Everything is a pendulum. Things swing in one direction, and hopefully when it gets as bad as it's getting with resolutions against Israel and this UNESCO, will it swing back again? But Lou Kerner and I were just discussing it in the break, Rabbi Wall, to try and understand this increase in anti-Semitism. You know, I think students are feeling it on campuses. They're more, according to the WJC, the World Jewish Congress, there have been more anti-Semitic incidents in the United States. We certainly know Europe is in a bad shape. But that's the negative news. And then you have someone like Lou Kerner on the show, and you get the feeling of just how successful Israel is. I mean, not only was the Technion invited to have a joint campus with Cornell in New York, but Lou, you mentioned something about a campus in China. You were at a conference in Israel with a Chinese. Can you give us a little bit of a flavor of that?
Sure. So when it was announced by Mayor Bloomberg that the winning university proposal for the New York Tech University was the partnership between Cornell and Technion, Peretz Levy, who's the head of Technion, said that one of the very first calls of congratulations he got was from Lee Kai-shing, who's the richest man living in Hong Kong, you know, multi-billionaire, and also an active investor in Israel. And Lee Kai-shing asked Peretz Levy if he would partner with him to build a similar university to what they were building in New York, with a university that Li Ka-shing was associated with in China. And so they're in the process of building out that university as well. And so it's really going to give the Technion a really unique global footprint among all universities in the world.
That is exceptional. So we have to just enjoy the wonderful things that Israel is achieving. And we spoke about why Israel is achieving it. We talked about the impact of the military, and then in the break we talked about other factors, like I think immigration was one of them.
Yes, immigration is a really interesting factor in that at the time that the book was written, 9 out of every 10 Israelis were either immigrants or children of immigrants. And statistically, immigrants tend to be much bigger risk takers because in large part because they have less to lose. And so they really believe that that was one of the driving factors of the entrepreneurial success that Israel was having. In addition, one of the other things that I was mentioning was one of the reasons I always thought that Silicon Valley was so successful is because of the incredibly supportive environment that it is that, you know, so many people there are in tech, and it's really the ethos to be very supportive of other people in tech. And I had never seen a city that had that kind of support system. You know, here in New York, you know, tech is a very small part of what we do in New York. I'm from originally Los Angeles. They have a growing tech ecosystem there, but it's still a small part. When I visited Tel Aviv, I was really blown away by not only how incredibly supportive everybody was of everybody else. You can't walk down a street in Tel Aviv without running into somebody else you know in the tech ecosystem and asking them how they're doing. And if they ask you for help, you know, giving them 10 people who can help them. And in some ways, I really describe Tel Aviv as Silicon Valley on steroids.
That's a wonderful statement, actually. And it's also, you give us a wonderful feeling of a sense of cooperation that's so important. And you had a taste of it in Silicon Valley. And now on steroids in Israel, where people are working together, we're going to be changing the world for the better part.
You know, I really say I'm certainly not the first person who has seen the extraordinary things that Israel has done. But I really think still, even at this time, as amazing as lots of the world thinks Israel is, including China and many other countries, it's still my very strong belief that the world still has no idea about the innovation and value creation that's going to come out of Israel.
So the potential, I mean, I think when you drive, and you, how many trips have you done to Israel?
I've gone 6 times in the last 16 months.
Oh, wow. That's inspirational. Is that mostly for business, or you have some pleasure, or?
It's, you know, all the trip is, you know, starts fundamentally with business. This was actually the first time trip that I went for 10 days, and I actually spent a weekend as a Tel Avivi, which is somebody who lives in Tel Aviv. So I didn't feel the need to actually go around and do any sightseeing. I just wanted to see what it felt like to be a citizen there, and it was an amazing, amazing weekend.
And when you drive, you see all these, on the highways, you see all these big companies like Intel, and I mean, you're just constantly seeing the tech companies, you see the signs, and it's phenomenal. Even I believe in Jerusalem now, Jerusalem has become a center for high tech.
Yeah, there are so many large corporations now who have presences there, whether it's Intel, who's the largest employer in the tech industry with over 10,000 employees, you know, or Google or Facebook, you know, almost every single large U.S. tech company has a presence there. But what I also think is incredibly interesting is even, you know, one of the most interesting early stage companies is called Magic Leap, and they've raised over $1.5 billion to really grow the virtual reality industry. And they opened up an office in Israel when they were just 200 people, because they really recognized that the most brilliant people in the world to help them solve the really difficult problems they were trying to solve were in Israel.
That's fascinating. Now tell us about you personally. How would the man in the street who now hears how dynamic Israel is get involved? What did you create? How have you created it? And how can we, any of us who have some dollars in our back pocket, get involved in making the sure bet that Israel is on the cutting edge of technology.
Well, one of the nice things that's occurred in the finance industry over the last few years is there have been the emergence of these investment platforms where companies can go, where individuals can go and invest in private companies. And so many of my Israeli investments, I open up to the public on a platform called AngelList, A-N-G-E-L-L-I-S-T, and I run the Israeli Founders Syndicate there. And so individuals can go and invest as little as $1,000 into one of the companies that I'm investing in.
That's fantastic. You know, I was reading one of you do blogs. And for the man in the street, it's quite a confusing thing. What is a blog? And I'd like you to discuss your last, your last six-point blog was fascinating. And I've also been reading about how important you feel change is. You feel that anything that stays still is going really backwards. Is that correct? So companies have to keep changing.
Yeah, undoubtedly. And that's really the challenge for a lot of large corporations, where not only do they have to change, but the pace at which they have to change is really quickening. And it's a struggle for many large corporations.
Oh, we're going to have to take a break. Always at a very important point, but we're going to come back because we have Lou Kerner with us. And Rabbi Wall is on the phone to enhance our knowledge of Israel and the Middle East and things of Jewish interest. We'll be back again with you.
And national news. Here is the latest update from Fox News Radio on 1460 WVOX.
Fox News Radio, I'm Pat O'Neill. Don't believe all the polls. That's what Donald Trump says about some presidential polls showing Hillary Clinton ahead, saying many are weighted in the Democrats' favor.
And what they do is they try and suppress the vote. This way people don't go out and vote. But we're winning this race. I really believe we're winning.
Trump in Palm Beach, Florida, where early voting has started. Democratic vice presidential nominee Tim Kaine in Miami pushing for Senate candidate Patrick Murphy while jabbing Marco Rubio.
I don't get it how you could call somebody a dangerous con artist and support him. Because we've seen Republicans around the country who have been willing to stand up and say, I don't tolerate what Donald Trump is doing.
He had this hit in the early 60s.
Take good care of
Bobby V, who had many hits, has died at 73. B got his big break filling in after the plane crash that killed Buddy Holly, Richie Valens, and the Big Bopper in 1959. Fox News, we report, you decide.
Insult women.
It's all talk.
Well, here we go again.
It's really bad judgment.
Issues, not insults.
She should be ashamed of herself.
The time for talk is over. Now, it's America's turn to make its voice heard. Fox News Channel has election night covered, fair and balanced, up-to-the-minute exit polls, breaking race results and powerful analysis from the best team in politics. Plus, it all happens live from our new state-of-the-art studio. Fox News Channel has election night covered because we are America's election headquarters.
There's more to Fox News Radio than meets the ear. Go behind the headlines and join the conversation on the hottest stories of the day on the Fox News Radio Facebook page. Be a part of the Fox News Radio Facebook fan community. Post comments and tell us your opinions. See behind-the-scenes photos and videos and post your reactions to the stories that matter to you. Click the like button on Facebook and connect with breaking news and features like Fox in the Fast Lane, House Call for Help, and more. Go to Facebook.com/Fox News Radio.
Happy birthday, Empire City Casino. It's their 10th anniversary, and they're celebrating all month long. Big promotions, record-high jackpots, new giveaways, events, and, of course, lots and lots of winning. Try your hand on the electronic table games or hit it big on the slots. Come to Empire City Casino to play, party, and win all day, every day. Make their 10th year your luckiest year yet, and thank you for making Empire City Casino hit the jackpot year after year. Just a short drive away, Empire City Casino is right off the Deegan Expressway, Metro north of the 4 train. Empire City Casino, game on!
It's all about thought, folks. Hello, this is Guru Madeline, and I'd like to invite the WVOX listeners to tune into The Power Within with me as your host every Friday afternoon from 3 to 4. In these stressful times, I want to tell you how thought accomplishes that which it desires in truth to accomplish. The quality of our thoughts, that is what my show is all about. Please tune in every Friday afternoon from 3 to 4 to The Power Within.
Westchester's last remaining local community station. This is the one and only 1460 WVOX.
WVOX.
Hello, this is Barbara Fix and Rabbi Wall talking about the Middle East and Israel. We'd love you to call us at 914-636-0110. We have a wonderful speaker today. We're talking with Luke Kerner about Israel's incredible technology advances. And Lou, you have a blog which you write about your numerous trips to Israel and what you have observed. Will you share with us your observations, please?
Well, sure. The latest post, which I wrote last week, was called Six Lessons Learned on My Sixth Trip to Israel. And, you know, among the different things I wrote about I really learned about on that trip, you know, one was how much, and you mentioned it earlier, Jerusalem is happening in terms of the growth of their tech ecosystem. They actually have a company called Mobileye that's a publicly traded company that has about a $10 billion market cap in the autonomous car marketplace. You know, they have the leading radar solutions that the cars use. And so they're really the poster child of success for Jerusalem tech companies. But there are many, many other companies, Lightrix, which was started at Hebrew University, which is the leading photo app on both iOS and Android, is an Israeli company. And I can go on and on. You know, there's so much happening in Jerusalem. It was really exciting to be there. And, you know, also I'd known about Mobileye before I went, but I also visited with a number of other companies that are leading this autonomous car revolution. And I really became aware that there's going to be this really tremendous wealth outside of Mobileye, built by companies, you know, helping to drive the autonomous car revolution.
That is absolutely fascinating. I mean, one could go on discussing with you, because if you get cars that are self-driven cars, firstly, it's makes us nervous as are they protecting the people inside the car? They're protecting the pedestrians outside the car? There are all sorts of questions about that. And also about jobs, and is it going to put every bus driver out of a job and train driver and pilots out of a job? There's so many questions. We have to have you back on the show again, Lou. You mentioned that you on one of your trips, your most recent trip, that you met with the head of innovation for the Israeli Air Force. Air Force.
Yeah, that was really fascinating. Because they talked about their innovation program and how they innovated the Air Force, and I was really struck by how sophisticated they were. That I visited with a lot of large U.S. corporations about how they're driving innovation, and I really believe that what the Israeli Air Force is doing is as sophisticated as what I've seen at any of these large corporations. You know, one of the things I asked them was to, you know, I'd known I'd actually put this individual in contact with somebody in who is driving innovation at the Army about 6 months prior. And so I asked him how that dialogue was going and kind of what lessons he had learned and what differences he saw. And he said that he had actually gone on a visit And he said one of the first things that he was struck by was all the saluting that goes on. He said there's no saluting in the Israeli army. It's much less hierarchical than our army. And he also talked about how that the army and the air force and the navy in Israel are really operate almost as one entity. And he said that, you know, part of the struggle that the folks that he was working with in the U.S. Army was there were a lot of territorial battles, and that, you know, quite often they're fighting with the different the Navy or the Air Force instead of working collaboratively. And so, you know, you hear these stories and you just think about, you know, how amazing the Israeli Defense Forces are.
That's one of your themes, is actually cooperation. You talk about the eco-tech system, and now you're bringing up that point about the importance of the military working together, the branches of the military. So that's really important.
Thank you, Barbara. Thanks for putting this together, and thank Lou for me and with all of our listeners, and we'll come back with more. We have about
7 more minutes, Rabbi Wall, that we can try and squeeze out of so much information. You're quite right. We're very appreciative of. Do you have any question for Lou right now, Rabbi, from Florida?
Well, I think that the whole idea, the link between the Jewish people outside of Israel and in Israel, the link is very, very important. For many years, the Bonds for Israel program allowed people to make small contributions and get maybe a part of a bond, but at least they're being tied to the land of Israel in a real sense. But lately we haven't seen these offers of the people who might want to make a very modest contribution should have a vehicle where they can do that. And I wonder if Lou got any sense of how these programs are going forward in Israel now.
In terms of, I'm sorry, Rabbi, the programs to help bring funding to the companies?
Yes, just allowing people to feel the tie with Israel. I say Bonds for Israel was doing this, but then they outpriced themselves and seemed to only be interested in larger donors. Well, that's true, but we who are trying to build a climate of recognition and resolution for Israel into the future would like to see the common, ordinary citizen have an opportunity to invest, even if he not be a large investor.
Sure. I think that's a great point. I think that, you know, not only obviously there are a lot of great philanthropic organizations like the UJA and others that are very helpful to, mm-hmm. to and APAC that are very helpful to Israel. By investing in Israeli companies, whether it's through me on AngelList or elsewhere, I think it's a great way to not only hopefully make money for yourself, but it's a great way to help the Israeli economy. Obviously, we're all aware that BDS on campuses, you know, boycotting, divesting, and sanctions against Israel is really on the rise. And these are organizations whose sole purpose is trying to hurt Israel economically. And so by investing in the Israeli tech ecosystem and Israeli startup companies, I think that's a great way for people to fight BDS. You know, by helping Israel economically, you're really fighting directly against the people who are trying to hurt Israel economically.
And you actually mentioned a number. I'm not sure if you mentioned it on the air or if it was during the break, but you mentioned $1,000 would get somebody into investing in a startup company. Is that correct?
Yes, that's the smallest amount that that AngelList allows an individual to make. But that would also allows an individual to, you know, with a pretty small amount of money, to build up a diversified portfolio of these investments, so they don't have all their chips in one company.
Rabbi, do you feel that answers your question? Do you have a follow-up question?
No, I think that answers my question. This question of bonds of unity between Israel and the Jews and the diaspora and the Christians, too, who love Israel, so many of them, that we should pay more attention. Some things can do very well without our attention, but those areas that require our attention should be induced to do so and allow us all to participate in the miracle of Israel.
That was very well put, Rabbi Wall, and quite inspirational. I think I'm going to take up your suggestion, and with Lou's permission, I'm going to put $1,000 with Lou, which I will discuss, and you call it Angel's List. Is there, if we go online, Lou, to look for Angel List, A-N-G-E-L-L-I-S-T, one word?
That's correct. And then when you're there, if you just search for Lou Kerner, L-O-U-K-E-R-N-E-R, or the Israeli Founders Fund, you'll be able to see the work that we're doing.
Right. That's exceptional, because it's almost like a win-win that way, Rabbi. And I'm pleased that you mentioned the Christians, because there are a lot of Christians that are feeling that Israel's being penalized and do not like the BDS boycotting Israel, trying to bring Israel to its knees. And this is a win-win, because if you can help, you can help yourself by hopefully making a lot of money by investing in the brilliance of these startup technology companies. You can also help change the world and make the world a better, safer place. So you're helping everything. You're helping the future of the world, you're helping Israel, and you're helping yourself. It's a three-way, win-win situation.
Barbara?
Yes, Jill, you're on the phone.
Jill, yes. Count me in, number one. And number two, I would like to know, pardon me, how we find Lou's blog.
So you can find my blog, thank you for asking, on medium.com. And again, if you search for Lou Kerner on Medium, you'll be able to find my blog.
Okay, great.
We're going to invite Lou back again, hopefully, to come and answer some more questions, because I think there are many subjects we didn't touch on. But thank you, Rabbi Wolf, for this opportunity. Thank you, Jill, for your question. And a big thank you to Lou Kerner for enlightening us on amazing developments in the technology world.
We'll look forward to hearing him again.